You've heard the sound, and you've seen the sight before. It's not a pleasant sound. It's not a pleasant sight. It's a casket laying in a grave. And then it's the sound of the dirt and the thud on top of the casket. It's the stones that hit the smooth surface of the casket and careen to the side. It's a sound and a sight that provokes tears. It provokes tears because it brings sinful human beings like you and I face to face with the reality of our sinfulness, that dust we are and to dust we shall return, the scriptures declare. And there's something final about that burial, isn't there? There is a reason that people weep at gravesides, because it gives a real, tangible finality to the death process. Paul uses this picture of the finality of the death process in a very unique way. You see, by using this picture, Paul is actually telling us what life is about. And maybe you're thinking, wait, hold on a second. What on earth does death have to do with life? Aren't these two things polar opposites? And you'd be correct. And that's actually exactly Paul's point. Paul says, now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. Paul is talking about, in this section of scripture, our topic of discussion in our midweek devotions, and it's baptism. And Paul's point about baptism and the life that baptism gives is this. If you want to understand the life that baptism gives, you must first understand the death that baptism brings. You see, at your baptism, water was sprinkled on your head, and the name of the triune God was spoken over you. And it looked pleasant. Your parents were there, your sponsors were there, maybe even a doctor or other individuals or an assembly of Christians, and they all looked on and they smiled. But what happened in reality there at the font was very violent. You see, there at the font, a war was raged over your soul between the forces of God and the forces of Satan. And by God's grace and the power of God, God won. And in baptism, Christ then makes you a part of his story. And maybe that doesn't mean anything to us until we first understand what Christ's story is, until we understand what story we're being made a part of. Well, Paul is sure to tell us what story we're being made a part of. He says it in two "we know" statements about Jesus. He says, for we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. You see, in baptism, Christ pulls us into his own story. And Paul tells us that Christ's story is one of a death and a resurrection. We know that he died, and we know that he was raised from the dead, Paul says. And when Christ died, he died to sin. You know what it means to be dead to something, don't you? It's as if that person or that thing or whatever it might be, it doesn't even exist in your life. For all you know and care about, the thing could be buried 6 feet under the ground because it's out of your sight, it's out of your mind, your back is completely turned toward it, and you live completely with it out of your life. Well, Paul tells us that the death that Christ died, it was to sin. Christ is dead to sin. And the life that he now lives is with his back completely toward sin and his face completely toward God. You see, Christians, what happened there at the baptismal font, it wasn't a peaceful scene. You see, if we were to be made part of Christ's story, we first had to die. If we were first going to enjoy a baptismal life, we first had to undergo a baptismal death. So with your salvation in mind, Christ made sure that he was there at your baptism. And first he killed. He killed you, the sinner. Because sinners cannot go to heaven. That's a myth that we often believe, that reformed sinners go to heaven. No, God wants nothing to do with sin or sinfulness or sinful people. So first, this killing and this drowning had to happen. It was necessary so that he could make you then alive. But notice the intimacy. Paul says earlier in Romans chapter 6, he says, "We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life." Dear Christian, you did not die alone. Christ took your hand, and he went with you each and every single step of the way. He died with you. He was buried with you. He was raised with you. That is the miracle of baptism and the faith that it creates. It ties you in the most intimate way with Christ. What could be more intimate than dying with someone, than being buried with someone, than being raised with someone? Christ has died. Christ has risen. And Christ now lives for God. Paul says, if you have been baptized, and you have, then that same story, that same picture, is your picture. It's your story. Paul says, in the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. You see, these words, in Christ, it's really the heart of it all. All of this is dependent upon existing within Jesus Christ. And that's exactly where the beauty is. Because for us to exist in Jesus, Jesus first had to exist in us. And through that word and water filled with the promise of the Most High God, that same Most High God makes his home in our hearts and takes up residency inside of us and creates life where there once was none. And that life, it was never intended to be lived on your own. No, Christ goes with you, even there. Paul says, the life you live to God. Now, on this side of eternity, you know as well as I do that we don't live with our back completely toward sin and our face completely toward God. The baptismal life is not some kind of unchallenged existence where we get to do exactly what God wants us to do and have the freedom to do it unhindered and unchallenged. No, of course not. Baptism surely does give us the freedom to do what God wants, to say yes to godliness and no to sin. But you know as well as I do that that little sinner inside of us is constantly battling for the place on the throne of our heart. And if we give into it, you know as well as I do that it's going to rear its ugly head and it's going to take us. So you and I then need to kill that sinner each and every single day. And that is why Paul uses this image of the finality of the death process. You see, Paul says, go back to the graveyard of the font. Go back to that graveyard of the font and look at the finality of what was killed. Look at what was buried. See it die again. See it buried again. Don't dig it up. Leave it there and turn your back on it and walk the other direction and see what was raised there. See the life that you live in Christ. See who you truly are. Paul says, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus, and then walk in newness of life with your face toward God. So then I suppose the question is for you and I, dear Christians, how do we visit the graveyard of the font every day? Well, I suppose you could go and visit your church every single day and visit the baptismal font that serves as a reminder of what is yours in Jesus and where you died and you rose, but maybe that's not super practical to make a trip to church every single day. Maybe more practical is your baptismal certificate. Do you know where it is? Maybe it's in a file somewhere. Maybe it's even in Mom's scrapbook. I don't know. Find it and take it because it belongs to you. Hang it on your wall and let it serve as a reminder to you each and every single morning that you lay your eyes upon it of the reality that as surely as Christ lives in you, you have baptismal life in Him. That reminder gives you the confidence to face anything that this world could throw at you. And then as you lay your head down to sleep at night, and you lay your eyes on that baptismal certificate again, you sleep in confidence. And knowing that where your shortcomings came through the day, where sin reared its ugly head in your thoughts and your words and your actions, it's washed away in the flood of your baptism. And you sleep, knowing that whether you lose everything that night, even if you wake with a terrible sickness, or even if you don't wake at all, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because you've already been through death and back with your Savior Jesus. Even when Satan condemns you, even when your own conscience turns on you, no matter what life has in store for you, you can say, bring it on. What do you have for me today? Failure? Pain? Sorrow? Death? Yes, even there. When your body lays there at the base of the chancel steps, it's really not final. No, baptism gets the final word there too. Because there by the casket stands the font telling how God received you, where you already died, where you already rose, where God reminds those onlookers that He is not the God of the dead, but He is the God of the living. Death holds no mastery. Satan can bring no charges. That is the life that you live as you cling to the waters of baptism. So Christians, my encouragement to you today is this. It's Paul's encouragement. Count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus, and walk in newness of life. You already died. You already rose. You have nothing to fear. Dead in Christ, alive in Christ, all that belongs to Christ is yours. That's a real, tangible finality to life. And not just any life. The baptismal life. And that's a life worth living. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for taking my sin so seriously that you did away with it at the cross. Thank you for being there at my baptism where you brought me into your death so that your story could be my story. Give me the strength to revisit the graveyard of my sin and leave it there again each and every single day, counting myself dead to sin and alive in you, all because of your baptismal grace given to me. Amen.
Our God will go before us and guide us by His presence. What confidence this promise is, we will never walk alone. Through unknown paths, through shadows, our hearts fear. For every step, His faithfulness is the truth that lights our way. Our God will go before us. The Lord of hosts is with us. Oh, praise the one who leads us on, for His grace will bring us home. Though evil forms against us, all heaven will defend us. The gates of hell shall not prevail, for the battle is the Lord's. Our God will go before us. The Lord of hosts is with us. Oh, praise the one who leads us on, for His grace will bring us home. Now send us with Your presence, and lead us on to heaven, where songs of sorrow